Grab your character sheets and roll those dice. Today we're talking tabletop RPG Lite.
Let's geek out!
Hey, I'm PK.
And I'm Bozer. And today we're here with Talai.
Hi.
How are you doing today?
Doing
great. Great. Thanks for joining us on FGBG, where today we're talking about tabletop RPGs Lite. It's not quite your typical RPG, your D&D, your Pathfinder. It's more of your light, your casual gamers, your Bozerhoons gamers of tabletop gaming.
So I guess my big question is, what, I know, like, obviously D&D and Pathfinder, there's a long ongoing story, is what makes it light that you can just, like, end it in one session, or?
Yeah, what's the biggest difference between this and a typical tabletop RPG?
I would say that there's less initial buy-in from the players. So a lot of these will come with pre-gen characters. A lot of what goes into the beginning of starting an RPG or starting a new campaign is who's playing what, how do you want to make that character work, what are they going to do, what's their backstory, you know, what is their long, sad story, are they an orphan,
right.
Was their wife murdered, like all this other stuff. With these characters, it comes with a name, comes with abilities, usually a short little blurby about where they're from, why they are the way that they are.
How many parents they have.
It's the hero's journey. They are all orphans.
Aren't we all?
Yeah, deep down on the inside. But it'll usually come with pre-gen characters so that you know who they are, what their abilities are, and it gives you that kind of base starting point so you don't have to sit there and think, do I want to be a mage? Do I want to be a barbarian? What in the world is it that I want to be? So.
Sure.
That I would say that's the big difference between light. The other thing is your sessions are probably going to be shorter.
Right.
They're going to play quick. It's going to play like a chapter. And then you can just come back to it every week or not, or leave it for 4 months. It doesn't matter. Whereas like in D&D or Pathfinder, you have to take notes. You have to remember where you are. You have to remember, did I sell this thing? Am I still carrying it? How much weight am I carrying? Does that make me move slower?
Right.
You do not have to worry about.
And this just keeps
these.
Track of it. So later, correct. Maybe in a different episode, we'll talk more about D&D and Pathfinder and that really typical tabletop RPG. But for those who've always been interested in doing that kind of thing, but maybe wanted an easy way to break into it, this would be your gateway, yeah?
Correct. Yep. So I brought a couple examples of these games. Some were proposed to me. Some are ones that I feel are genuinely super good starting out.
Okay.
So the very first one I would introduce is Mice and Mystics. This is a low buy-in.
Down there, yeah.
If when you were little you liked reading like the Redwall books or anything like that,
right.
It's a fantasy setting. You play as these little mice, and they're trying to get around this castle, basically. The buy-in is nice and low.
Right.
This is one that we play with our kids. My 8-year-old loves to play it, but he started playing it about 2 years ago. So you can play this game with relatively young children and have them understand the rules, have them kind of learn how to role play as a specific type of character, learn what they're supposed to do if they're the tank, if they're ranged.
Right,
that
like
type
how
of
you
thing.
Play into the right settings.
Correct.
And the minis in it are really adorable.
They're so cute. And the training wheels for it are just awesome. You play against like little centipedes or spiders or, you know,
right.
Stuff that mice would encounter. Everything's very small. Those are not painted. Some of the other ones I brought are. We just have not painted those.
Hey, you picked the non-painted ones.
I did. Yeah, well, yeah.
But they're
no,
adorable.
There aren't any painted ones
paint
in this one.
Okay, so there's none in that one. That's pretty
those aren't even primed. We don't tend to, my husband and I don't tend to play that game as much, like, as adults. We play it with the kids. My husband plays it
right,
with
so
the
it's
kids.
Literally just to get your,
to get
your
them
kids
started.
Into
it.
Great opener for kids.
Yep.
Which, it's interesting, because that would be too complicated for my wife.
But the nice thing is, everything that your character can do is all contained on one card.
Mm-hmm.
How fast they can move, how they attack people, how they're going to try to get through. And different characters are introduced at different points in the story. If you progress, not only do you get to level up, but you get to introduce two new places. It comes with a nice game board that kind of snaps together like a puzzle.
Cool.
So that you can flip pieces around and actually see where you're going.
Right. And then that one has the storybook, right? That you like
correct.
Follow...
Yep.
Which I heard that's really cool. It's a nice
it's
little
It's very linear.
There's not a lot of, like, hey, we're going to go off on this side thing. You don't do that in these.
You just really focus.
Correct.
Now, is that also kind of a staple to the light side of it, where there's not, like, where, like, in D&D, I can go off and get stuck in a town for 3 days?
You absolutely can.
Right. Like, we've done it. Like, we've gone off on our journeys, and we're like, oh, I'm going to own this town by the end of this. Yeah. Like, this is just, like, we'll never come back. I'm like, that's fine, but I want to own it, so let's work.
We came and we liberated this town, and now we're the overlords.
Yeah, I was so bad for dungeon masters that are DMing me because we're going on a train track they didn't expect.
Like, oh, I had all this other stuff, really great monsters planned, but yeah, let's just
stay here. They've got this giant binder ready to go, and now they pull this little notepad. I'm like, oh god.
Have a meeting.
Where are we going?
Give me about 5 minutes. Everybody take a rest. I have to figure out how are you going to fight this new magic couch, I guess. Like, and that's a good point of D&D, is part of the fun of playing those deeper games is you can find fun ways to break them. And your DM, so.
And it's not been a good DM session if you haven't broken.
If you haven't seen them break a sweat at least once, or bust out like the bestiary to see, like it's just not.
And so this kind of game wouldn't even have a DM. The game itself would be a DM.
Sort of. So that's a good segue into Imperial Assault, which is my favorite of the ones that we brought.
And you can see it there. You can actually see
you
it.
You can. You can tell that a lot more care has gone into it. We've actually painted the minis. He's going to show a couple of them.
Now,
there's my Boba Fett.
Now, are, like, they all the ones in this, are they going to be, like, actual, like, main characters or, like, side characters?
No. So, we own, because my husband and I both really like Star Wars and we both enjoy Imperial Assault, we own 100% of the game with all the expansions and all the side missions.
Gotcha, okay.
So if you buy the base game, which ironically our children bought their own copy of the base game because they love the minis so much and they like playing, but we didn't want them to lose our pieces, so they saved their money. Bought their own version of it, and it comes with a couple of the main characters, like...
I saw Lando
over
there.
This one, Lando is a side mission, Chopper's a side mission, Boba Fett comes with, like, a separate pack. But, like, you play as Alliance versus the Imperials.
Nice,
so the nice thing about that one is the DM is interactive, so the DM is the Imperial side.
Okay, so... The DM will actually play as, like, the entire...
Correct.
Just like you would in, like, an actual, like, D&D.
Yeah, but you're playing 4-on-1, and he knows all of the rules, all of the twists that are coming up. So he really is DMing. Usually that person, I say he because my husband does it.
Right.
It could be anybody. Usually he sets up the game, tells everybody where they're going to start, and then when you start, everybody puts their characters where you want them. He reads the opening scene that says, oh, you've parachuted into this Imperial base. You need to break in and turn off all these computers. And then once you're through this door, then the game will progress. So all we know is we have 6 rounds to do X, Y, and Z. But the only thing we know right now is we have to get through these doors. And there are these stormtroopers in the way. So you don't know where you're going. The DM still does. But the DM is playing as the Imperials. And depending on how you go...
He has to find a way to cut you off.
He has to find a way to cut you off. He might spend some of his threat points to get extra people to come in, or he might have had somebody that he won in a side mission that he can just spend his points on, and suddenly IG-88 shows up in the corner and just blasts you all. And, or, you know, like, we had one mission where we won Lando, so every time the four of us were out there, and then Lando comes on too, which I love, because I love Lando. But...
Is he your man crush?
He is 100% my main crush.
Originally,
as a child,
Donald Glover.
Okay, first of all, both.
All right,
no,
just like the character itself.
I enjoy the character, and I loved Billy Dee Williams. Like, growing up, I don't know what it was. Empire Strikes Back. I think it was the cape, to be honest. And the fact
the cape's scary.
The fact that in Solo the capes were so integral the entire time I was watching that, I was like, yes, the cape is bespoke. Like. It was such a thing in that movie. I was so excited. And my kids are, like, leaning over, slapping me, like, Mom, it's Lando. You like him. And I'm like, yes, I do.
Thank you. Thank you for making sure people know.
But, I mean, it's fine. Other ones would be, like, Zombicide. It's not really a true RPG because it's not necessarily a campaign. But your characters do level up. You're playing as a specific...
Right.
A specific type of character. So you are a tank, you are DPS, you are
and then
healer.
Every level has their own end game. Like, there's a way to beat each.
Correct. There
map.
Is a way, and then you can pick different scenarios. So you are kind of working your way through a story, but you could pick up and do one of the stories in the middle.
Yeah,
or
you can just pick
at the end.
Because they have different
you
order,
don't.
Right?
Correct. They do have difficulty levels. Yeah. I wouldn't recommend starting out on the most difficult.
Because you're just going to die.
So this one's, I mean, it's a little bit shaky whether or not that one's like a true RPG because it is episodic, but you do level up, and I think that's what kind of puts it over the edge.
I know. Oh, sorry.
Go ahead and talk about this last one, but then I want to go back to that question about,
okay,
like, what truly makes it an RPG because of what makes it a campaign.
So I was requested to bring Betrayal at House on the Hill, which I totally did.
By it's, my request, I will own it.
It sparked a little bit of controversy in my own household about right, whether or not this is actually an RPG. And you do play as a specific character. That character has specific traits. Your mental abilities or your physical abilities are plus or minus depending on what you are. If you're a tiny little girl, not as strong. Right. If you're a running back, definitely stronger. But then maybe your mental capabilities aren't
right.
They're not all there. Good. So you get a really cool gun, and but you're terrible at
he's real fast.
The reason I asked you to bring this is because to me, an RPG role-playing game is in Betrayal or even in Zombicide, you get a character and you have a set of traits about that character. And whether or not those traits change, whether they can level up, it's still, you're still playing as that person and you're playing that role, and each character has its own role within the kind of framework of the game. And especially in Betrayal, it like follows like a story, and it, mm-hmm. especially on what, depending on which omen you get, then it unlocks some right. insane
hundreds of endings.
What so was
many
that called?
Different ones.
What's it?
When
you finally get the last omen and
when like the betrayal happens.
The betrayal.
That means the actual name.
Is this another Stan Lee for you?
Oh, we don't talk about
that. Episode one.
But to me, that like you really then truly live in that moment, and especially whoever is like the cursed one and has to take the book in the other room and figure out what their goal is.
For 15 minutes.
Like, 15 minutes every time.
Sort out what it is.
That's like, never been me, by the way.
End goal here?
But to me, that's what makes
always,
it an RPG.
It's
is
always Roberta.
Even
Adam's
if you don't
sister.
Level up, you're still like immersed in the world as a single character.
So that brings up an interesting point. You are playing as a specific person and trying to fulfill a specific role. I am playing as an 8-year-old girl with weird, like, sausage curls and big old doll eyes, and she's got a pinafore on, and she is scary as all get out.
I've picked her before, yeah.
She is terrifying. Or, you know, we've got one in there that I call her Detroit Lean, because when they cast the actual character, like, she's always, like, leaning way back.
She really?
Yeah, it's just, it was a fluke of the way that they made the minis in that specific game. Like, our copy.
Oh,
not
okay.
everybody's.
I was like,
Detroit
Lean. It was just ours.
We
she's
opened,
leaning.
I was like,
no, and okay. anyway, you're playing as a specific person, but I think the thing that's different is it's not a campaign, and you're not truly leveling up even though you're changing your characteristics. You're not getting to a point where you're like, okay, we completed this thing. I have so much experience, therefore I unlock these new abilities.
So because it's so episodic in the sense that as soon as this story's done, we reset back to zero and keep moving.
Correct. And you could make the same argument for Zombicide too. That's the reason why I said those two are maybe a little bit different. But what I would say when it comes to like Betrayal, if that's going to be your baseline for this as an RPG, you could make the same argument for like... Seven Wonders. If you're playing Seven Wonders, you're playing as a specific wonder and you're trying to build that wonder, and you get specific abilities based on whether or not you're the Great Pyramid of Giza or if you're the Library at Alexandria. You get to do different things.
Yeah, but the fact is it's not a person.
It's not a person, but it's...
That's where I get hung up on it.
If you boil it down to like its basic structure...
You have to pretend to be somebody else.
You have to pretend to be something else. Now, what I would say is different about, say, Imperial Assault is that, so when I play this Jedi character, which I've played her
this
through
one?
Entire campaigns before, she gets fantastic abilities. And based on what I decide, and when I decide to spend my XP, she can do a thing called a snap kick, where she literally, right after she attacks, she gets to come back and like basically kick somebody standing next to her as hard as she possibly can. She can learn to throw her lightsaber. She can do all sorts of different things, but it's my choice mm-hmm. based on how
so
many
got
times
skill
you want.
Tree and like how you
basically,
want to play it.
Yeah.
There's a lot of avenues where
that
seems like
routes.
Second tier RPG.
So you're playing like RPG super light. That's why you're at over here. Like, we've gone past light. Now we're at, like,
diet.
I gave myself light. A different name. So, I mean, the whole point of an RPG is to immerse yourself in a world. Yeah. So, if Betrayal does that for you, I mean, I think that's great. I really enjoy people who appreciate the story that goes into these games, because the art, the story, all the background. So much to it. I mean, even if you're talking about like Mysterium, when you play that game, you can play it with an app that comes with like special creepy noises. Or like if you're playing a game like Stab Thief, it does the same thing. So like when the thief is running away from you can hear the can hear like the background street noises, or you can hear them open or shut a door. So, I mean, there's just a lot of levels that go into these games. And if you connect with it there, that's great. Like, I don't care. I'm all about spreading the gospel of gaming.
Right. You know, like, tabletop is very important.
Preach.
Yeah. So.
So from it too far, I wanted to ask that, and I meant to put it in the beginning. Whoops. What got you into tabletop gaming? Because, like, for me, I would have never gotten into it had it not been for first Matt Mercer and his gang of people doing Critical Role, and then going further into it, I got to really get into it with Will Wheaton on that same channel.
Tabletop. Yeah.
So if it wasn't for that whole crew at Geek & Sundry, I would have never gotten into this world in the slightest. But
our Lord and Lady Felicia Day and Will Wheaton.
I like bowed down to both of them. If it wasn't for them, I would have never gotten into this. And I remember seeing Felicia Day the first time in was it the Guild?
Supernatural. Oh, the Guild. Yeah.
The Guild. And
which I thought was really creative of her to do that, because when it was one of those things where I think I read a thing where she said that she had a serious addiction to like World of Warcraft, and she was missing auditions because she was running raids with her group. And I think that does say a lot about the amount of investment that people give. And don't get me wrong, I'm not saying you should be addicted to any of this stuff. There are limits. You need to have a real life. But there is something very comforting about being able to go into this different world where you have different
universe.
You can leave your stress behind.
You can be who you
want
to be.
And you know exactly who you want to be. You can be what you want to be. And you can solve your problems with violence, and it's not a problem. Nobody's actually getting hurt. If you know, in one of these games, I start bashing goblins over the head with a shovel. Like, would I ever hit anybody with a shovel in real life? Absolutely not. No. Does it look super awesome?
Don't Google it.
Don't. But, you know, like, there is a certain amount of release where you're just like, yes, I can absolutely solve this problem with brute force.
Right.
Or there's other times we've been running dungeons and you ended up solving the puzzle purely through strength of intellect.
Uh-huh.
So what am I going to do about this well that keeps producing these magical fairies that are coming out and attacking us, and we're having a hard time getting rid of them? We drank the well.
I usually
that got rid of them.
Well, as you said, and I think I love that because, like, I mean, I've DM'd a little bit now, and every time you go into it,
bless you.
Oh no, it's hard because I want to be in it, but I have to, like, you know, I've done DMing enough at this point where I can control it, and
no, you can't.
No, I can't.
You can't.
It's a madness.
Controlled chaos.
We should do an FGBG of D&D, like playing through.
I think that'd be fun. Like,
at least
just
a portion of a game.
Just like one little campaign.
Have like little pocket campaigns, like one chapter campaigns.
Yeah. We can do that. I've got a whole thing of it. And anyway, off topic. But a lot of it, like Ray and our group of friends that had done it, a lot of times they'll come at it with like, we can solve this without violence. We can do it by outsmarting these people. And I'm all about it. Like, if you can do it without violence, go for it. And
sometimes it works out.
Right. They've outsmarted a ton of people. A lot of times we don't even get to like have battles. I'm ready to fight. And they're just like, actually, we'll cast this spell, confuse this, do this, and like they chain it all together and their roles work out.
Yeah.
And we don't see blood at all, and they just kill themselves.
Well, I mean, we had one situation that we ran into, speaking of people that kind of like to break the game, where one of our friends got caught in the basement of a mercantile with the owner's daughter, and he came down all like, I'm gonna beat the crap out of you. What are you doing down here with my daughter, mister? And Adam looked at the innkeeper or the mercantile owner and said, it's okay, this guy's gay. With his diplomacy, critted a 20.
Oh God.
Plus 5 diplomacy. And it became canon for the rest of the game that every time we went to that town, that character that wasn't even Adams had to pretend like he was gay so that the mercantile owner would not come and murder him for being caught in the basement with his daughter.
That's so good.
It's one of those things where, like, this, I mean, we could see no way that we were getting out of this situation without having to murder this guy because, I mean, he came down with, like, a cudgel. Like, he was ready to spill blood.
Yeah.
And it was a diplomacy role. The character who ended up having to pretend to be gay is an incredibly straight guy that we know, and he was a little bit upset with us for hijacking his character, but it totally worked out.
It was that, so, or murder.
It really was, and we didn't want to kill the shopkeeper. He gave me a discount the day before, so he'd been super cool to us.
Race Seduced a Dragon. I forgot about that one.
Nice.
Yeah, it was a good play.
I mean, use what God gave you, right?
Right. That's what she did.
And without getting too far down the rabbit hole of D&D and that.
We're supposed to be light.
Right. And we just went,
we're keeping it light.
Full on.
But if you have been listening and you've been watching and you're like, oh, that sounds really awesome, I want a way to break into it. Like, this style of game, these
good.
Are obviously there
it's
are
good.
Such
a good
hundreds more with this kind of thing.
Yep.
But it's gives you the storylines. You don't have to create it your own.
The DM will have such an easier time of it. And it's good if you're trying to learn how to DM too, because that is a deep pool to jump into.
Oh, yeah.
So having something that's pre-written where everybody can kind of read the rules, be on the same basis. And the whole thing about gaming in general is just having fun, being cool, hanging out with your friends, giving yourself something to do where you can all have a shared experience. And whether that's in a made-up world or like a pseudo haunted house type deal that's based on the creepy house that's down the road from where you grew up.
Right.
It doesn't matter. It's
we
about sharing
right.
something and
yeah.
giving you something to look back on 15 years from now when you're just like, hey, you remember that time we did that thing? I mean,
it's always a good time.
In Imperial Assault, I remember there was one time we were running, and I know how my husband is when he plays as the Imperials. He will chess move you off the board. He will run that clock down. He will block you out so that everybody is taking so much damage that there's no way you can avoid it. And that is how his mind works. He's the worst person to play as
that's
the
meticulous.
Imperial.
Good
he is
God.
Horrible.
Whew.
We were playing with another couple friend of ours and our friend Adam. And it got to the point where in this game, if everybody gets wounded, the Imperials automatically win. So if he can deal enough damage out to all of the characters, he will focus down on one person, get you wounded, then you can't use one of your abilities, your hit points go down, and your movement goes down.
Yeah.
He will focus you down, each and every single one of you, until he gets to the last one, and then it's just a matter of him maneuvering his pieces so that he has line of sight, and he'll just shoot your head off. It got to the point where all we needed to do was open a gate so that Luke Skywalker could get out. We just had to get him out. We didn't have to actually leave the compound, just get him out. And we had one friend who was 2 hit points away from being wounded. The rest of us were all completely wounded. And that guy's turn, the smart move was staying in the corner where John couldn't hit him, because he was located in the one corner that John could not get line of sight on, no matter how he moved his pieces or what he was going to do. And Toby was so mad because I would not let him move. And I was like, if you so much as move that piece, I swear I will never speak to you again. You stay in that corner and you let the rest of us do our job. That's your job, to stay in the corner. And we actually ended up winning because he stayed in the corner.
But he wasn't able to do anything.
He wasn't able to do
Toby.
Nobody puts Toby in a corner.
We did put Toby in a corner.
That's the title of the episode. Put Toby in a corner.
He'll love it.
But I love that even in this kind of game where it's a box game, you open it up, you set it up, you can really get immersed in that so much that, like, you know, you have, it's like you can almost picture you're there on the Imperial base, Tatooine,
or Endor,
and you feel like you're under fire and you're telling Toby, don't move, you stay in the corner.
You stay in that corner or I will hunt you down and I will personally put you in the ground.
Nobody can heal you. Somebody else will get Luke out.
But I think the other thing is, like, going back on the DM side of it, like, things like D&D and Pathfinder, if you never tried it, are very expensive.
They are.
And it's
these
so easy.
Games aren't necessarily all cheap either,
but
they're going to be less expensive
cheaper,
than
right?
buying a lot of D&D books.
Well, and, like, and Mice and Mystic. Like, if you want to see if you like that fantasy style, like, role-playing, like you said, it's that's, like, the lightest it's going to get.
Yep.
It's, I think it's like $60 or something like that.
Something like that. And Imperial Assault, the buy-in is a little bit more salty. I think the base game runs $90.
Right.
Depending on what discounts you get, who you purchase it from.
Yeah.
But that being said, we always balance it out against, like, how much does it cost to go to a movie? So.
Right.
Well, I have AMC A-List, so future sponsor of FGBG.
But, I mean, like, if you get the Monster Manual, the Player Handbook.
They're like $50 a pound.
Yeah.
35. So well, you, oh, like 35.
If you get the three main books, though, when they're not on sale on Black Friday, it'll set you back $100 right there, but you still got to get the minis if you feel like that's what you want to do. You got to get the stories, because none of those are actually storylines. You can get some free ones online sometimes, but...
Well, the nice thing about D&D is that it's open source. So the way that the game mechanics actually work are open for anybody to use. That's the reason why Paizo has Pathfinder. It's based on D&D rules and mechanics. They did not come up with how those rules all interact. They pirated them perfectly legally.
Right.
Because D&D is open source.
Right.
I love that. I love it.
It's like somebody using Lynx on their computer. It's all open source. They just reskinned it as Pathfinder or Starfinder. Mm-hmm. But the nice thing about it is once you have those rules, and you can find a lot of them online, if you're willing to go basic pen and paper, you can play this with one set of dice, your pen, your paper, and your imagination. Mm-hmm. That's how Gary Gygax originally conceived it, and that's how it all started, which I think is there's something really beautiful about that. It can get really expensive. I mean,
but
you can
have to be.
It does not have to be. In that way, kind of the heavier D&D sort of works out over these, but these are much simpler to kind of dip your toe
and
in.
Then, like,
and the artwork and the craftsmanship is just gorgeous.
Well, as far as the painting, I should point out that's all post.
Yeah,
You don't get it like that.
Yeah. With his little blood effects and his shading.
That's really great.
Yeah,
he loves that.
That's tedious and time.
I'll have to take a photo of some of this and post it later.
Yeah.
Yes. And if you're curious about any of these, we'll put them all on our Instagram so you can kind of see it, and we'll give a description of most of them.
Yeah. So, I mean, they're worth getting into. There is nothing better than being able to have that shared experience with the same friends where they come back to your house every week, and you really get to understand people under pressure and how they approach solving a problem.
Yeah.
Are they a person who's just going to bash through a door? Or are they the person that's going to seduce the dragon?
Like, right. And
which really brings us to a...
Yeah, 100%. It was so funny. Like, it was probably like the best moment in our campaign when we got to this town.
Hey there, fiery boy.
Yeah, she's like... She tried to cast a spell on him to, like, brainwash him, but he was, like, way too powerful. I was like, that's not going to work. We rolled it. Clearly didn't. He just kind of laughed it off. And then she just, like, I'm going to seduce the dragon. Now, the thing was, she had a charisma of, like, nothing. She was an uncharismatic... But, like, I mean, you check the stats of this dragon, she somehow beat it out. I don't know how she did it. It was...
This dragon was, like, scraping bottom of the barrel as far as relationships go.
He just burned a whole town to the ground, so he didn't have a lot of options, you know?
Well, I mean...
This person.
Dragons are rare, few and in between.
But you brought up a good point. When playing this kind of game, it's kind of important to find a good group that balances well.
Which is hard.
So, talk to me about... the kind of roles that you need to find in your friend group if you're looking for...
Sure. So balancing a group can be important in two ways, and I'd say there are two sides to that coin. The first is who the people are in real life that you would play with. So it's important to find somebody like my husband who's more than willing to memorize all of the rules and know when you're going off the rails. And then it's important to have people that are... willing to work together as a team, understand each other's sense of humor, don't mind spending just weird hours together.
Most of the day.
Yeah, I mean, and it doesn't have to be hours and hours long, but you have to be able to get along with the people. Am I going to do this with my mom? No. My mom, honest to goodness, would get pretty tired. It's not knitting and it's not sewing.
That seems like a Sushi Go kind of time where let's just whip these cards out real quick.
Yeah.
And
funny you should mention that because your mom is a subscriber to FGBG.
Oh, no, she's
hello.
Not.
Hello.
No, she's not.
Oh.
No.
I was getting all excited. I was like,
no, she's not. But the other side of that is balancing your group within the game. So like, for example, I'll go back to Imperial Assault because it's the one I like the most.
Yeah.
You're still going to want to do things like you would in World of Warcraft or even Overwatch where you're balancing your party. So you're going to need a tank, you're going to need your DPS, you're going to need some sort of healer or somebody with a lot of speed, depending on how you're playing it.
Right.
You have to pay attention to that. How fast can your character move? How much damage can they take? What exactly does it take to hit them? What do they roll? Like, what kind of defense die? So, like, the Jedi character I was talking about, she rolls a white die. And on that, it's got one blank side where she literally defends nothing and I just take everything that's given to me. But on the flip side of that, she has one that literally blocks everything. So if I roll that side, doesn't matter what's rolled against me, negates everything.
Ooh.
Then there's other ones that'll roll the black dice, which will block either one surge or actual hits. And surges usually go toward like bonuses that you get with your weapons, okay, or with a special ability that you have. You get right. So many surges, you get to do X, Y, and Z.
Right.
So you have to pay attention to what they're rolling, if they're ranged, how far away do they have to be, what weapons are we going to give them starting out. I want to give people with lots of range the sniper weapons.
Right.
If I'm going to be melee, probably want to have a pretty kick-ass, like, in her case, she doesn't start out with a lightsaber, she starts out with a staff. But, you know,
dang, okay,
you want to kind of balance how you're going to start out, where everybody is going to be placed, who's going to be a blocker.
So there's a real synergy to it all.
So there is. And the characters work well together if you balance them properly. You don't want a group of all snipers. They don't have the hit points to be able to take melee.
Right.
But if you get a couple Wookiees in there who've got charge, who have a lot more hit points just because they're bigger, bulkier, they
can take
battle
of it while you stay on the back.
Correct.
Right, right, right.
Yeah. So Garkon.
Yes.
He's super fun. You know, you want to pay attention to how you're balancing your group so that you can fight things
so
off.
That's where
because
really
a smart DM or Imperial side will look for weaknesses like that in the balance of your group, and they will exploit them. Because you're not playing against a book. You're playing against a people.
A person.
You're
this
playing against
like
a smart people.
Your husband.
In our case.
I'm
going
to be honest.
Yeah.
I remember you told me to get this one, and I was like, kind of like, oh, Ray doesn't really like Star Wars that much. I'm like on the fence about Star Wars,
yeah,
the whole video about it.
The flavor is
like
Star
RPG.
Wars, the function is RPG.
Which, that I can get into. Like, and I don't know. It sounds fun to kind of, like,
before you buy any of the expansions, there's one that's kind of broken and busted, and it's not.
Avoid that one?
Yeah. You probably don't want to play that one. I can't remember which one it was. This last one we did. I think it was the Hoth expansion.
Uh-huh.
It's real broken, which, and they even admitted, Fantasy
like,
Flight. They were like, whoops. This
My
one,
bad.
There are a whole bunch of blogs out there about how it's so broken because once one side starts winning, it snowballs and they keep winning and the other side can never catch up and it just becomes an absolute stomp fest.
Yeah.
So, luckily it was the Rebels that were stomping on the Imperials, but my husband did not find that to be
so I can't
fun.
Imagine. So, I guess that's actually, it's not on there, that's a question. Things like that where they make broken things, like,
we fixed it.
So you had to personally, like homebrew fix it. Well, I was curious because, you know, like Overwatch, if they put like Lunar Space Colony out, broken map, it
yep.
favored one side heavily, they had to go back and fix it. They can patch it. Video games can patch things.
Right.
Do board games have like a similar mechanic if it's still like live, like Imperial
no,
Assault?
No, not especially. Usually what you'll do is you'll end up getting on forums and saying, hey, this is the campaign we're playing. It is not working out. What is it that we're doing wrong? Why is the one side always winning? Come to find out, it's because the rewards that they were offering at the end of each chapter, episode, if you will, mission,
right.
They were severely lopsided. So if you won, you were getting 2 experience points and all this other stuff, whereas the other guy was basically getting
nothing.
Chump change.
Oof.
So they're never going to catch up to that kind of
uh-huh.
snowball effect, because once you start getting really good abilities, or in the case of if the Imperials win, they just get all these people to start out with.
Oh, God.
And you will never even make it through the front door.
So very overwhelming.
It can be. So the way we fixed it is we started giving better rewards to the side that ended up losing.
To balance it out.
To balance
it
out.
I lost, but I get to still
I lost, and yeah, there's a bonus, but it's not as much of a bonus because it was too good of a bonus for winning in the case of the Hoth expansion. Not the case with the Bespin expansion or any of the others that I can think of off the top of my head, but you can fix it yourself. And a
right.
lot of times you'll find that on boards. The board gaming community is super friendly. Everybody likes to give out information. There are some really good Facebook groups where people are just very good about supporting each other. And
can you think of any off the top of your head?
So I'm part of a board game group on Facebook called Board Game Revolution. We've got like 25,000 members or something
dang.
Like that.
Okay.
Across the entire Facebook's
running
world.
This down.
Good move.
And it's a super supportive community. Everybody likes to get on and just discuss, okay, what are you guys playing this weekend? This is what we played this weekend. Did you enjoy this game? Did you not? And it's kind of how my husband and I decide which board games we're going to buy, but it can also play into games like this. Like, what's broken in Imperial Assault. You will just get response after response after response because it's a pool of 25,000 people across the globe. So, you know, we all get super excited about the same games. Maybe it comes out, everybody buys it, and we're like, meh.
Right. That was a little rough. Because, I mean, or, especially with the, was it, Kickstarter board games are huge.
Kickstarter board games, especially, a lot of people are really into minis. So the minis look awesome. A lot of people will buy into them. But then maybe the game's not so awesome. Like, Rising Sun has the most awesome minis on the planet. Like, you have never seen.
Yeah.
Super, super detailed, very awesome. Luckily, with that game, it's got a cool mechanic. It plays well. But there are a lot of rules that are involved with it as well. So you have to kind of balance the two.
Yeah.
That being said, we also, my husband and I at least, pay attention to what publisher is putting out which game. So like in the case of Mice and Mystics, it's put out by Plaid Hat Games. They, in general, do games that we really like. They're lighter. They play fast. You kind of know what you're getting into when you get one of their games.
And so, when you say play fast, how long is that?
So, like, they have I can't remember what the name of the zombie game is. I'll probably get it wrong. But, like, an hour, maybe, every time you sit down. So, like, if you're going to have a board game day with your friends and you don't want to sit down and play Mansions of Madness, it's going to take, like, 4 hours.
Right.
You can sit down and play maybe
a
Mice and Mystics, or you can sit down and you can play like Takenoko for a little bit, or you could play Takedo or Machikoru, or
some shorter ones.
Some shorter games that just keep things lighter so that people don't get so bogged down in the story, especially if you're not interested.
What was that one that you said a while back when I was looking into this for the first time? It was like you go into, there's like a storyline and you have to like solve the puzzle. If you don't solve it by the end, you like reverse time and try to.
Oh, Time Stories.
Time Stories.
So.
You heard of this one?
Yeah.
I have not.
Oh my god, this one. I almost, this one's kind of pricier, and I almost thought to buy
it. So, if you're going to play that one, and this is the other nice thing about knowing people that play board games, we had friends that got married for their wedding. We bought them the base game of Time Stories. With Time Stories, you play one episode, and once you solve it, you are probably never playing it again, because you know how to get through the puzzles.
Right.
We bought her the base game and said, hey, when you guys are ready to play each episode, let me know, you can borrow ours. And they're $20 a pop.
Right.
So, we bought her the base game. She has her own base game. She can just borrow the episodes from us as she wants.
Nice.
She doesn't have to put out the $20 every time.
Which
is
nice.
Then she just gives them back. And, you know, if you bought Time Stories, we'd loan them out to you, too.
Ooh. Yeah.
Because
you have quite a collection at your house.
We have a sickness. It's the best sickness, but we have a sickness.
No, you'll probably never see Talia's house. But if ever you do, what it looks like is what I one day want, like, my basement to look like. Like, it's the ultimate batch pad.
The Shrine of Nerds.
The Shrine. Ooh. Their whole house. They've got shelves and shelves and shelves of
board games.
Yep.
They've got everything with the Funko Pops of every kind of fandom that you could want.
Just
Overwatch,
like
Harry Potter, Lord of the Rings.
Overwatch is up above the TV. We've got two series of Stranger Things. We've
got
the Disney
Walking
Pops.
Dead.
We have the Lord of the Rings. We have the Star Wars.
Oh, yeah.
I have the Futurama Pops because that's my...
All your
people.
Framed pieces are all...
It's all Lord of the Rings
nerddom
art.
Or it's like the ultimate. So you are witnessing one of the ultimate geeks here on...
Right.
Like, geeks by geeks.
Yeah.
She puts us to shame by...
Total shit to shame.
Every
well, and
word.
The funny thing is I was talking to friends of ours before I came to do this, and I was like, honestly, if they wanted to know, like, deep stuff about board games, you'd be talking to my husband. He would never... ever agree to come on something like this because he wouldn't want to be on camera.
So this is like, we got the light version
of
this.
You got like the ambassador version
got
of
it.
What my husband could bring to this, but.
Okay, so you're saying Plaid Hat Games are good. What are some other
They're
publishers
lighter.
That people might
so
want to
So
Fantasy look for?
Flight, which did Imperial Assault.
Okay.
They know their business with games with intricate rules. So they do a lot of Star Wars stuff.
Right,
everything that they have
well.
Is probably... Imperial Assault is actually probably lighter for some of their games that they offer.
Wow.
But
so they're good at like finessing really extreme rules.
Yes. And there's detail and everything is just designed to like the nth degree. So
and that's not easy to do because
no,
I bought Fallout, the board
mm-hmm.
game, and that's just a mess.
That game is hard to play.
Kind of like Fallout 4.
It's hard to play. It really is.
Fallout 76.
Well, we got it because my husband really likes Fallout.
I love Fallout.
I love a good deck building game. So we were like, yay, it'll kind of be like your flavor and my kind of game. It'll be great. And then it's just a lot of kind of stumbling around the board.
Yeah.
You
know what's intense? When you have the rule book and then the in-game rule book that you have to keep out
As you play.
Like, there's two rule books. There's this thick, like, rule book.
Yeah, you didn't do it right.
And then you've got this other rule book so that while you're playing the game, you can refer to this rule book.
So what's the rule book for?
To understand the
base.
Game.
It's just to get you, like, into the door.
Yeah, I don't... That's called bad design.
Yeah. So now, if you want to talk about well-designed games, I will go off on a little tangent. My husband and I love Stonemaier Games.
That's another publisher?
That's another publisher.
What do they make?
They make... So Scythe is the one that they're known very well for. Yeah. Their most recent game is Wingspan, which admittedly I haven't had a chance to play. It just came this week, so we'll probably play this weekend. Viticulture, love that game. You own your own winery. You bottle wine, sell them.
I think I've heard of that one.
It's actually super fun. It's a worker placement game. I like worker placement games.
Define worker placement.
So you get a X number of workers in a round or a turn or whatever, and you go out and you make them do different things. Everybody can choose to have theirs do any of, like, say, like 10 options of things to do, and you basically craft your own game based on where you play your pieces.
Yeah, they played a game like that on...
Lords of Waterdeep.
They played that one. That was with Felicia Day. But there was another one where, like, they had to go get clay, they had to go get materials, but then you could also have, like, babies, build boats, go... And, like, it was weird, but it seemed really cool.
Like, Champions of Midgard? I don't think that was out when they were still doing
stuff. No.
But yeah, usually you're playing out your meeples.
Yeah.
But anyway, we love Stonemaier. They have My Little Scythe. They have all sorts of just super, super fun games to play. They're not really RPGs, though, so totally off topic.
Yeah. But.
But.
Amazing publisher.
But I will shout out to them every time somebody brings up publishers.
Cool. We'll put all that in the caption below, just so if you are looking for kind of games, whether it's a publisher or whether you're looking for a Facebook group that you can connect you to other game players maybe in your area, we'll put those in the
details and find below. your friendly local gaming store. We have some really good ones in the area.
Definitely.
Secret Door in Elkhart is fantastic.
Right downtown.
Definitely go to them. They're
fantastic.
Amazing.
They could not be kinder. And that's kind of when I was talking earlier, like, I make jokes about, like, the gospel of gaming, but you will never find more open, welcoming, kind people than you will usually at your local gaming store. They literally do not care.
Oh, no.
Race, creed, sexuality, none of that stuff does not matter. They just want to know that you're going to be cool when you sit down and you play that game. And even if you don't know the rules, most of the time they'll teach you. So everybody
and at
loves
least
a
secret
teach.
Door, oftentimes, I'm sure any game store, they have certain days where it's just like,
come on in. Yeah.
We're going to be playing this game and we're going to walk
we'll
you through.
You.
Or there's just open game plays where you can grab a game off their shelf and there'll be somebody there to walk you through.
They have, like, mini painting nights where, you know, you pay X amount of dollars and you can go in and paint a mini.
Yeah.
So you don't have to pay for the paint because it can get super expensive.
Pricey. That
kind of
pricey,
paint.
Pricey.
Yeah, for that kind of paint. So find a local game store.
And, like, side story on Secret Door Game, like, I wanted to get into Magic really badly.
Yeah.
And I went in and this guy literally got out 5 starter decks. He's like, we just give these up for free, so these are yours, but let me teach you. And we played a whole game of Magic just sitting right there just because he wanted me to understand it. And, I mean, it was an incredible experience.
What a great
you should definitely
job.
It's one of those things where there's not so many slices of the pie. There's, like, infinite slices of pie. So just because I have this ability to game and I'm good at these types of games, I want to share that with you because your knowing how to play that game increases my ability to play it exponentially because it gives me another person to play with.
Yeah.
Right.
As opposed to it being like, well, I can't give away this information. If I give away this amount of information that I know, then there's less for me.
Right.
There's infinite ability to know about these properties and being able to share that is just valuable. And it brings people together, and it's a super cool thing to do with your spouse, too. So.
Right, yeah. I can definitely say that, because Ray and I got really into it. We had a friend group, and we decided to, like, have a game night. Like, every set day, we go out, we play not usually RPG games, but
it
tabletop games. Right, like, we just like playing tabletop games, so we got into Villainous. I don't know if you've tried that.
We have not gotten that yet. I want it so bad, because we love Disney.
It's so good. The rules are intricate enough where it's not like... Like Sushi Go, where you're just...
Slapping out a card and doesn't
kind
matter.
Of like, and then, like, collecting your points. But instead, it's, like... You have to think... Every person has their own set of, like... I have to do this. This is my win condition. And everybody has their own win condition. So you're playing against each other.
Uh-huh.
And for yourself. So nobody has
the flavor is fun.
Oh, my God, yes. So if you like Disney and you
I guess in the world of RPG light, like this is like light, but it is, it's cool. Like
it's caffeine free.
Yeah.
Diet.
Like it's
water.
What's LaCroix?
I'm playing his
LaCroix.
It's LaCroix.
It smells like a burp of fruit from 3 feet away.
Yeah. That's what it is, because you are technically role playing as the villains, but once it's done, it's done. But
they're, I cannot say enough for find people to play with. People will find you. Sometimes it takes a while to get a group together, but your people are out there. Your tribe is out there. Just find them or they'll find you.
And if they don't want to like just immediately jump into like Settlers of Catan or D&D, ease your way
totally
into it.
Totally ease it in.
Right.
Yeah. You gotta start people out with the training There's wheels. Plenty. It's fine.
Right. Get Ticket to Ride.
And until then, love Ticket to Ride. Because my wife loves that kind of game. Her favorite thing is Ticket to Ride.
Ticket to Ride is so good.
She doesn't have the attention span for this kind of thing. I love this kind of thing. Her brother, my brother-in-law, is super into this. And he's rivaling your collection slowly. But he's getting
there. But I mean, good for him. How fun is that to have people... Like, people want to come over to our house, and it's a little bit of a scam because then they have to come over to my house and I can wear my pajamas. This is a little bit of a scam.
Right. But it's a fun scam. Wear their pajamas.
You got food. You feed us. To do that. We have a game table.
Yeah.
Right. With the cup holders.
With the felt. The video with Adam cup shared. Holders. I was like, oh my God.
Oh, you have the cup holders. It's like sliding to the side.
Yeah. I know.
But bringing it back to the RPGs, as a character...
Yeah, no, you see that?
So far gone.
Beautiful segues.
As a character, they tend to go through quite a lot. Yes. You know, we ask a lot of our RPG characters. We put them through the works. So we thought it's only fair that we might do the same for them. So that's going to bring us to a game that we like to call... What are the odds?
Oh no. one in 20.
Why... This is one of those things where, like, we wanted to play a game, and I was like, what do we do? And I had this idea. Actually, thank you if you're watching Caden. Caden and Kate Dilly, they have this game. Yes, they have this game. What are the odds? And you say, like, 1 in 20 or 1 in 100.
Yeah.
And we played it in New York City.
Yeah.
And that's where this idea came from. And, like, looking at this...
Caden, if I have to eat salt.
So, PK, tell us how we play.
So, just like in... not RPG light, D&D, or other games like that, you have to roll, like, your constitution. Oh, God. And no. Depending on, like, the fight, they each have their own, like...
What is that?
Set.
You're so weird.
So...
Bacon bits?
Things like Ready Whip would be really light and have, like...
Are we supposed to eat the candle or lick it?
I don't know. We'll see.
Lick it.
We'll see what the odds are.
Oh, God.
It's a candle that smells like feet. You just have to smell it.
What's
wrong with you?
So...
I'm taking my dice and I'm going home.
She's just leaving. Like, this is the end of the episode for Banna.
Ba-da-ba-ba-da-ba.
So we're going to say, what are the odds that you would eat a handful of bacon bits? And so we'll each decide what our odds are in accordance to a d20. And then we're going to roll that d20. And if we are within our safe frame, then we don't have to do that thing. But if we fall outside, just like our poor RPG characters, we have to suffer the consequences.
You're going
to
take the hit.
Take the hit.
Take the hit. That's what we should have named it.
Take the hit.
Take the hit. Aww.
We like to play a little game called Take the Hit.
Not going to edit it out, but I do like that. I like that name better.
We'll play it again.
So I'm going to play this through. What are the odds you'll eat a small little cup full of bacon bits?
A plastic shot glass full.
Yeah.
Well, not real shot glass.
I don't even know what these are. I found them in my cabinet.
It looks like a pill... Like a pill thing. It's
a
separator?
A pill bottle.
Like that your grandma had all of her vitamins in, like her fish oil pill
so
or whatever.
So if I were to say like 5, if I roll higher than 5 I have to do it or less than 5 I have to do it?
I would say, oh, that's a good call because you would think if it was good, you'd want to roll higher. I don't know.
Well.
How do you want
to
do
it? Okay, if you were attacking a character and they had like, you had to roll a 20, you didn't get to a 20.
Okay. So it's, okay. So, like, if you don't mind it, like, with the Ready Whip, you'd probably say, like, 2. And if you definitely don't want to do it, like, with the vinegar, you're going to say, like, a 20.
Right. Okay. So, like, I just have to roll above it?
You roll above it, then you have to do it. You roll above, you have to do it. You take the hit.
Yes. Okay. So I take the hit if it's above like a 2, but if a vinegar, I'm going to say like 18, and if I roll a 19, I'm in trouble.
Yeah, yeah. You're going to be taking a swig of vinegar.
So this is bacon bits.
So
what are the odds?
A 2.
Okay.
Spit take all over the place. Oh,
I would say...
just bacon bits, right?
I don't know what's in them, so I'm going to say it's textured soy,
so
flour, canola oil, salt, caramel color, maltodextrin.
But bacon is too easy.
And red dye number 40.
Oh,
ooh, so bacon is too easy. Yeah. So what about bacon and Ready Whip together?
I mean, I'm a big fan cocktail of like crunchy and smooth.
Yeah.
So, it's
so okay. I would say for me, for the Ready Whip and the bacon together, I could probably do like an 8.
I'm telling Ray you're
crazy. I was going to say 8 as well.
8?
Because my nose is stuffed. Because if you haven't noticed, I've been blowing my nose of a cold. So I can't really taste anything anyway.
Must be nice. What about you?
Oh, gosh.
I won't make
Are we making it so that we can't ever pick the same number again? Otherwise, I'm just saying like 20 every time.
I think you can only say 20.
One time.
Can we use your 20
I'm
going
to suggest you hold off for the vinegar.
No, I'm going to hold off for the salt.
Oh.
Well, you don't know what we're going to mix it with.
Yeah, I mean, this is not like a one-off.
Okay. I'll say like 7.
7?
I'll go in between.
Okay.
In betweeny weenies.
So I just have to roll... less than an 8 or higher?
If you roll higher than an 8, okay.
you have to do
take
it.
Oh, gosh.
Okay.
11!
Gross.
I'll just start this out.
You start making your cocktail.
Yeah.
Let's see.
Oh, it smells like dog food.
I said 8. Let's see what I gotta do. I got an 8!
8 or higher, you're doing it.
What? Yeah. No, 8 was my threshold.
No, 8 or higher, bro.
Oh, how man, do you that even... smells horrible.
It smells like dog food.
I should have gone higher. Do you have one of those little shot glass things for me or am I out?
Oh, here's that
oh,
one.
There's the...
Oh, we got plenty for all of us.
Crap.
Okay, so you're taking it.
I thought I was getting out of this.
How do you even...
Aww. At least it wasn't a 1.
I think if it's critical, you have to do it twice. That's the one thing.
It wasn't. If you roll a 1, you're doing it.
But it was a 2. So
you had
7.
So you don't have to. But I do. How do you even... I'm going to do my Ready Whip and my bacon bits on top.
I did it backwards, but...
Because I don't know how you're going to eat that.
With this
very carefully.
And you need to be kind of generous with these bacon bits.
The dog food. It's
oh,
dog
my
food.
Word. It, honest to goodness, smells like a dog treat. Like it a sausage.
Good.
It smells like sausages. Do it.
Cheers.
Dink it.
Here
take we go.
The hit. How is that evil? If you throw up, just do it over there. I don't have socks on.
Why are we doing this?
You're the one who wanted to play a game. We could have been talking about publishers still. Lick it out. That'll help.
I don't even remotely have all the whipped cream.
Probably tastes like the backside of a fart.
It's not great. Oh, God.
I am praising God for this stuffy nose right now. I can't imagine it tastes like to you. It tastes like...
Take a drink, man. Take a drink. It's so code red right there.
I finished my...
Oh, no. I'm out of Coke.
Okay.
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 What's next?
Next. That was the starter?
You're the one that started this. Cover that up, man. People can still smell that.
Things get harder.
You're making it worse. You're making it worse for David.
Maraschino cherries and salt.
Oh, I don't really like either of those.
Yeah, you might want to make that one high. I'm going to go 15.
I'll say 12. Because of my stuffy nose. My plus 3
like
stuffy nose.
Plus 3 to smell. I'll go...
Did I say 15?
Is this a 20?
Yeah, I'll go 16.
Okay.
Okay.
All right, you go first, Paizo. Oh!
I got 17.
Oh, no. Oh, no!
19! And I said, what, 12?
Yeah.
Oh.
You're gonna roll like a 4.
6!
You little twit.
Let me help you with that. Got your Morton.
It's a good thing you drank everything in your mug.
Oh, good thing these have these little things.
Yeah. Oh.
Do we need a spoon or?
When did they expire?
I don't know. They've been in my fridge for quite some time.
But honestly, I don't want to die.
Oh, no, they're still good. Crap. I thought we were going to get out.
That would not get you out. It would just maybe make it worse. There you go.
Do you want that one?
I touched it. Put it in your little cup.
I'm not a...
Let me
get your salt in there.
I haven't picked my nose in like the last 3 or 4 hours, so you're fine.
We don't need to candy coat it.
Let me get your salt there, Tyler. Tyla, what's your name?
Whatever my name actually is. It's really weird calling people not by their real names when you actually know them.
Bozer's my real name.
Bullcrap. I've known you since you were 17.
You ready to take the hit?
Right. Chink.
Oh, that bacon's a weird taste. This is what cement tastes like.
It tastes better if you put the cherry flavor in your mouth.
I'm all in.
This is really...
Ugh, mother
this
fracker.
Is great
that
for
is
the podcast.
Terrible.
So, for our listeners, let me try to narrate what's going on. They're both dry heaving.
I think they can get the sounds.
I'm pretty sure those are universal sounds.
All that salt is stopping the cherry from actually making it down the esophagus.
Oh, no,
completely.
It's down.
It's down.
Just
it's been weird.
My mouth is just coated in salt now.
I think 2 more rounds.
Okay. I want to hear a suggestion from you.
Yeah.
From me?
Yeah.
I know how I want to end it, but...
I don't know, vinegar and lemon?
Oh, there's nothing good about that.
I feel like the lemon will cut the vinegar, maybe.
No, what?
Can you drink real, like, straight vinegar? I mean, you can, because you can have them on french fries, right?
Yeah,
right.
It's but,
white,
like, you clean your windows
distilled.
With it.
It's all natural.
I clean stuff with it.
You can drink vinegar.
Yeah. Oh, no, there's still salt in the bottom.
Oh, no. There's like bacon in the cream.
No,
it just gets worse every time
you lose.
Every time you lose, it stacks up and gets worse. So right now, I've got salt, cherry juice, bacon, and
I've just got a little bit of whipped cream.
Oh. Okay,
so what are we doing?
Lemon and vinegar.
Oh, no. Okay.
Boy.
Okay.
I'm going to go with 10.
Only I feel 10? Like you need to roll something other than the purple die because you've rolled it every time and it hasn't done good work for you.
I'm going to do the metal die.
So okay. Let's be super, super superstitious.
Let's stick
like,
with blue. Blue had my back last time.
See? You get a hot die, you got to stick with it. Okay, what are we all...
I went 10 or higher because I...
10
I,
or higher?
Yep, I'm going to...
He likes lemon and
I
vinegar.
I like punishment.
Oh, my word.
I'm going to do...
And bacon bits
log
and salt
that away about
and whipped
you.
Cream.
I liked my 12. My 12 had me through. That feels like an okay middle
of the
road.
I'm going to go 18 because I'll throw up.
Oh, please don't throw up.
There's a padded plan over there. I'll throw up.
Majesty. It's a majesty Paul.
Here we go.
Ready?
10 or higher, bro.
Oh, I'm
really... Oh, you're all in it. 2.
You...
Did we... No, all of us made it?
Oh,
no,
wait,
no,
he
I did
doesn't
it.
Have
no.
to.
I have a 19.
We both have to.
You guys get to. I don't.
I forgot
David's
how
out.
These rules worked.
Forgot. I thought I was fine. Turned out I wasn't.
Oh my god. See?
Oh, no.
10 or higher. You guys played too high.
I don't mind lemon or well, short of me saying 20.
That's true.
Okay, how many squirts of lemon do I have to put in this?
Oh, that might be a lot.
That's probably good.
Put 3. I'd rather drink lemon than vinegar.
That's fair.
Ew, that is the most disgusting thing
it's
I've ever seen.
It's got whipped cream mixed
it's
in
curdled.
My vinegar. It just looks instantly curdled. Mm.
Okay, if I can put up with my parents making me drink Alka-Seltzer growing up. I can do lemon and vinegar.
Maybe this is the secret to like.
Colds. You're gonna get rid of your cold.
Yeah, instantly.
You're welcome.
Okay.
Okay, right. Down the hatch. Jawohl.
Oh. Give me this.
There's a
No. No.
I have this face forever.
This is literally the worst thing I've ever tasted in my life. And I accidentally drank Mr. Clean when I was 9.
This
is worse.
Your idea.
This is worse. I made it real bad.
This is empty. Oh, God.
Oh, okay.
I can't.
Do you want to end it after
yes.
this?
Yes.
Yeah, it's last round.
It better
round.
Be the marshmallows.
Oh, yeah, there's sweets over there. What are we doing?
What's wrong with us?
Marshmallows and syrup?
No. All right. Marshmallow
one.
And syrup. Yeah.
Marshmallow and syrup?
Yes.
Yeah, one.
Buddy the Elf, what's your favorite color?
One. I'm praying I get this.
You have one. To if you get a one.
Yes!
4!
Alright,
okay,
we're all in.
Give me a marshmallow.
Oh, this is a good way to finish it up. The thing is,
no.
You gotta put it in the shot glass.
Oh no, there's vinegar in that!
You didn't drink all of it!
I did too.
That
the
is
remnants.
The worst shot I've ever taken in my life.
Ew.
Oh god, I'm so tickled. Maybe it's because they didn't have to take it.
Oh no.
There's like bacon.
That felt like waterboarding in my mouth.
It felt like drinking sandpaper. Tell me it didn't.
Drinking sandpaper.
Drinking sandpaper.
Oh, this is the.
It kind of made me think of like.
It was like regurgitated.
This could
barf.
Be really good. Actually.
It was like barfed up barf that you barfed up again.
This is the best worst game I've ever made.
It's all for you, all the fans of FGBG.
Oh no! It's dripping.
That's why you got to put in the shot glass.
Mm-mm, I'm not putting in a shot glass. Do you know what's in that shot glass? Disgusting.
All right.
What's in there?
Right. There you go.
Oh. What'd you get in with yours? Mine was fine.
Oh.
I haven't put it in a shot
glass. Oh, there's vinegar still. Oh no!
I told you not to put it in a shot glass.
Well, you have to.
But I didn't. Mine tasted like
happiness,
maple marshmallow. Yours probably just tasted like disappointment.
Mine's very salty.
Mine tasted
the tears of 1,000 Michelin men.
Mine tasted like the equivalent of Space Mountain at Disney World. Like you
the
wait,
floors?
Like no, you wait all that time and you're really excited about it, and then you get in there and you're like,
it makes you wanna
"Oh,
cry.
This could kill me." I could lose something important.
I can smell the vinegar from over here.
I think yeah.
Every time I ride that ride with one of my kids, I'm afraid he's just gonna go flying out of the seat. Like I'm gonna go out of there and be like, where's the child? They're gonna be like, oh, he's lost back there.
He's
lights are
just
off.
Gone.
It's fine. You have another one. Yeah. That was
well.
You know, one time we got the Jones Soda Thanksgiving dinner. And my sister, brother-in-law, and my husband and I all agreed to take shots. The cranberry was fine. The pumpkin pie was fine. The Brussels sprouts, literally the worst thing that you've ever smelled. It smelled like Satan's butthole.
I'm gagging just thinking about it.
And then it had turkey and stuffing. Disgusting.
Not okay.
Well,
it was not okay.
What a way to end the game, man.
No, bad drink.
And a way to end the episode.
Yeah.
Ugh.
Yeah.
So, if you stuck it out to the end,
sorry guys.
Hope you played along.
We probably can only apologize.
Oh god.
Oh, you can't even sign off.
Yeah, I know.
I can't.
My stomach's like freaking out.
Well, thanks for coming on today. How'd you enjoy
it?
It
was like a mile from my house, so it wasn't a big problem.
But we appreciate it. Like I.
No, it's fun.
I think it's one of the first times where I really got to like learn something where I wasn't like I'm not like not geeked about it, but I'm more geeked coming in than I was already. Like I think with Smash Bros.
I
want to
play
Overwatch,
some games now.
Right, like I want to play a board game. Like I want to try Imperial Assault.
Definitely.
Assault.
Well, now we know
I
where
feel
we
so
go.
Bad that you brought me on as the expert and everybody's gonna be like, I mean most of the stuff she said is like 75, 25, right and wrong.
Ah,
she just made it all up.
But if you do agree with what she said or if you don't,
yep.
Go ahead and just let's talk about it. Let's have a discussion.
What discussions
in the
are for, right?
Be
comments
gentle.
Below.
Be
oh,
God.
All of our FGBG fans
be
are gentle.
Oh.
Ding.
And if you did like and you haven't already, subscribe. Like the video so we know if we're doing something you like. Tell us about it. If you liked this challenge. I don't want to play water, take the hit anytime soon.
Never again.
Maybe not never again. But
it's going to come back.
Where
I'm at. Oh, I'm sure it'll come back. Just like this is going to come back up.
Going to revisit like the vinegar and the lemon.
Oh. I'm glad I didn't have to take that one. I'm very thankful for that.
Yeah, me too.
But until next time, I'm PK.
And I'm Bozer.
And I won't be there.
And you keep geeking out.